atmosphere is changing now. For the Spirit of the Lord is here. The evidence is all around that the Spirit of the Lord is here. The atmosphere is changing.
But, you know, one of the things.
Good morning and welcome to University of Carolina, a community sent to help anyone and everyone become a follower of Jesus. We want to thank you for worshiping with us on live this morning. You can find resources and ways to participate in our gathering by visiting www.ucumc.net/live. And I should encourage you to fully engage in the life of the service. When it's time to stand and sing, I encourage you to stand and sing. Bob and Sandy Fielding, I want to encourage you when it's time to sing, do that. Stand and send me a photo if you would. And just a few highlights of things that are happening in the life of the church. Our VBS online, our virtual VBS online registration is coming up real quick. So we encourage you to sign up for that. We'll be doing our virtual VBS June the 15th through the 19th. So take a moment and sign up. You'll receive a box. You'll pick that up. It'll have the crafts and all the activities that you will need with video links for VBS. So I encourage you to go ahead and do that this week. In fact, do it today, tomorrow, if you would. And then speaking of today, today is our drive-by farewell for the Brooks family. And that is after the vessel service at 1 to 3. It's between 1 and 3 today. It is here at the church. Please don't everybody come at 1. But it'll be between 1 and 3. We'll have you looping into the church parking lot and direct you to back at Epic, where the Brooks family will be under the porch back there at Epic. And so you can drop by, give them a farewell, decorate your car, have posters, have a lot of fun, but stay in your car if you can. Social distance from your car. We'd appreciate that. It's going to be a great day to celebrate the Brooks family. This is Bobby's last weekend here as a pastor at University of Caroline, and he is preaching in this service a little later. Also want to thank all of the folks who give week after week to Community Pantry to help friends and families and folks who are in need financially at Faith Church, their food pantry, as well as those of you who give week after week, even though you're not here, to the ministry of this church, and we appreciate that. You can drop off gifts of food or financial gifts to the church anytime, Monday through Friday, 9 to 3 in the afternoon. And if you need prayer this day for any thing that you would like prayer for, if you'd like one of the pastors to pray with you over the phone, please leave us a message or text us at 407-494-6204, and we will call you back a little later. I want to thank everyone for filling out the relaunch survey. That was very helpful for our relaunch team that's in the process of reviewing and improving ways to open our facility safely, and we have tentatively scheduled to relaunch on June the 20th and 21st. So in anticipation of your return for in-person worship, we're shifting our Sunday worship gathering times to allow a little more time for cleaning and sanitizing protocols. And so between those services, the new times are this. So the new times, effective next Sunday, the first Sunday in June, will be a traditional service. Will begin at 8:45 and we'll end at 9:30. 8:45, our contemporary service will begin at 10, and then our vessel service will begin at 11:30. Again, the traditional service will begin at 8:45, contemporary 10, and vessel 11:30. Set an alarm to remind you. We'll be sending out stuff on Facebook, social media, to remind you not to forget of those time changes next week. Now, if you would, let's stand and sing together this morning as we begin worship.
To his streams, river of living water. You turn my bitter into sweet, and all my burdens are lifted. You took the shackles off my feet. There's no sound louder than a captive set free. No, so let the redeemed of the Lord say so. We sing of his promises. Yeah.
that I wake up till I lay my head. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Hey church, it is really, really weird for me to be saying this, but this is my last weekend on staff here at University Carillon. I love each and every one of you so much. This has been such an incredible place for me and my family. We love each of you dearly. What we've learned and experienced here is just incredible. And so what I wanted to do is I wanted to take you on a little journey here, share some memories with you. And I thought, what better way to do it when so many people haven't been able to see the church is I'm going to just take you, I'm not going to tell you some memories. I'm going to actually show you them as well. So I hope you're ready. Let's get going. the first space I want to show you is right here. Currently, this functions as one of our preschool classrooms, but many, many years ago, like over 20 years ago, this space right here was actually our youth room. And for me, this place evokes a lot of memory. This was a place where I really began to feel and began to wonder, maybe God really does love me. And it happened in the context of friendships. I can remember being here one, I believe it was a Sunday night, we had a movie night, and on the way out, a group of the friends I've been hanging out with actually invited me to come have dinner with them after the movie night. I think we went out to Steak and Shake or something. But I remember in that moment beginning to realize that these friendships I was cultivating here in this room were real. And they were real because if they weren't real, they wouldn't have invited me out afterwards. And it was that invitation, it was that moment in this room that bled out into those other places that made me think if these friendships were real, maybe this relationship with God was real as well. Yes, we are in another preschool classroom, but this was not one of the other former youth rooms. This is actually the room where I was hired on to be part of the maintenance team here. I was out in the sanctuary, eating dinner with my friends, and this gruff, white-haired guy comes up to me and says, "Are you Bobby?" I'm like, "Yeah." He's like, "I need to talk to you." And I have no idea what's going on, and he brings me in here and he sits me down at one of these little chairs, and he tells me that he's got a job. And as many of you have, I'm sure, figured out right now, this was our beloved Joe Manuel, who was invited me to be on the pastoral, be on the facility staff, which in our eyes was the pastoral staff. That was actually more correct than we probably realized at the moment. But he invited me to be on the staff, and he said I could start as soon as I needed to. And I basically started the next week, and I had no idea that when I was saying yes to this, that I would be working with one of the greatest men and one of the greatest mentors and friends that I would be ever blessed to have. And that was initiated in this room right here. We're in the hospitality slash copier slash whatever we need this to be room. And this room has always been multi-purpose. And you go back about 20 years, and this was actually one of our Sunday school rooms. And this was the first place where I learned the feeling of conviction and repentance. Long story short, I kicked the chair out from underneath one of my friends for a good laugh. It worked. She fell. Everybody laughed. I felt great until I saw her crying. And the moment I saw her crying, I felt this like guilt and shame welling up, and it took place in this room. And I realized in that moment, I never wanted to feel that again. But my earliest memory of that experience of like knowing that it affects people, that wrongdoing can affect people, took place in this room. It's my earliest memory, and it took place right here in the copier slash hospitality slash whatever we need room. So I am in the front building stairwell that overlooks the front patio. And for everyone else, this might be a stairwell, but for me, this was actually the place where I first began to consider a calling in the ministry. I was coming down the stairs, and one of the Asbury Seminary professors who called this church their home, we were walking down, and he looked at me and just said, "Hey, have you ever considered ministry?" And from the rest of the walk, I just kind of, I don't remember anything else he said. I just know in that moment he planted something that I couldn't shake, and I tried to shake it for a while. But every time I walk in this room, every time I walk in the stairwell, I remember that conversation and the fact that God started something in that moment that has literally forever changed my life. You might look around and see another preschool classroom. I actually see the place where I fell in love with my wife for the first time. Love you, Anna. Long before this field was used for Upward, it was still covered in trees, and one of our scouts did an Eagle Scout project, and they did a prayer walk all through the woods back here. And my very, very first experience of the Holy Spirit was out on a walk out here on that prayer walk. I'll never forget, it was a cool day, and all of a sudden as I'm praying, I just felt this overwhelming sense of the power and the presence of God. And so every time I come out here, I think about that moment. I think about experiencing the presence of God, the felt, manifest presence of God for the very first time. Out here by the pond, I learned how to rest. Many of you have probably seen me fishing out here, and if you're wondering, no, there are no fish. There's a lot of casting, no fishing, but it's beautiful to come out here and rest, and I learned that right here on the pond. And this place right here probably taught me more about life and ministry than anything else I've ever done. There's too much to share with you, in this context, but I will share two things about this room right here. First, I learned very quickly that if you threw a dodgeball hard enough, you could get pretty much any middle schooler or high schooler to listen to you for at least a little bit. The second thing, and far more importantly, that I learned back here is this, that if you invest in people, especially young people, you're not just investing in the moment. You're investing in all the moments thereafter, and you're taking a step of faith and trusting God with your future. And it has been such a joy and privilege to see all the incredible things that God has done in my own life, in the life of my family through this place, and through the lives of all those who have come through here. Church, I've got just a couple more places to show you. The first of those is right here. I've had the incredible privilege of getting to be one of your pastors. And I've learned some incredible things, not just being able to teach and preach, but also being one of the people sitting out there. We've had the privilege of sitting under great teachers and preachers, which has been incredible. But as one of your preachers, I've learned some incredible things. One of them being, always bring an extra pair of pants just in case your zipper breaks. I learned that one the hard way. But the other thing that I've learned is that you have taught me far more than I could ever teach you. And for that, I'm incredibly grateful. I've got time for one more memory. There's many, many more things I wish I could share, but I'll end with this one. It was about 20 years ago, and I was in this room right around this space worshiping, and everything was going great. I mean, the band was awesome. The congregation was in it, but it was just one of those nights where I just didn't feel it. I don't know if you've ever had that, but I just didn't feel it. And I remember lifting up this prayer, not really expecting an answer, but I said, God, is this all there is? Is this it? Is this the extent? God, is this all there is? And I didn't expect an answer, but in that moment, I heard God speak for one of the very first times in my life. And again, not a audible voice, just something here. I heard God say, Bobby, as long as I am, there is always more. That was 20 years ago, right around this space, in this very room. And can I tell you, church, that for the last 20 years, God has made good on that promise again and again and again. With him, there is always more. So University of Caroline, I know we're going through a lot of changes right now, and I know things look and feel different, but we have a God for whom with him, there is always more. And so I pray blessing upon you. I pray blessing upon your family. I pray that you would have eyes to see and ears to hear the good, incredible more that God is doing for the glory of God and the sake of the world.
Still enough. Keep me.
This is my confidence. You've never failed. Your promise still stands. For great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. For this is my confidence.
Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for that truth. We thank you that you have not failed us. God, we thank you that even though life might not look the way we thought it would, even though life might not look the way we anticipated, even though life may feel completely out of control right now, we come before you, the King of heaven and earth, and we thank you that what you've done, we thank you for what you've done. We thank you for what you're going to do. God, we thank you that that even what you've done is just, you're just getting started. And so, Father, we do want to pause here for a moment and lift up the unrest in our world right now, especially in our country. God, we pray just for a spirit of revival and healing to wash over us. God, we pray against racism and racial injustice. We pray against anyone and anything that would devalue someone based on the color of their skin or the language they speak or where they were born. God, we pray that we would have eyes to see each other the way you see us. Lord, we pray for justice and we pray for peace. We pray for peace and we pray for justice, and we know these two things are intimately intertwined. And so, Lord, we give you this morning, and we pray that wherever we are and whenever we're listening to this, that we'd have an incredible, just sweet time with you. Would we hear exactly what you have for us? We love you, Lord. We love you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said, amen. All right, well, church, to our my contemporary 1015 community, I love you all. On behalf of my family, we just want to thank you for everything you've done for us throughout the many, many years we've been here. It has been such an incredible journey, and so much of who we are and who I've become and who my family has become has been shaped by your love and support. And so we hope you'll be able to make it a little bit later at 1 o'clock. I know my family and I would love to see you. I know it's just a drive-by and we can't get out and high-five and hug, but you know, air hugs and air fives are, they're better than nothing. And so we can't wait to see you here in just a little bit. And I can't wait to share with you what I feel like the Lord has for us this morning. From the moment basically it was announced, or at least that I knew that this moment was kind of coming up, I've been praying about this moment right here. I've been praying about, like, what am I going to talk about? Like, what am I going to teach on? And so this has been really a long time coming for me. And it's interesting, as I've been doing all this planning and praying, but it was really just this week that I really felt at peace with what I believe the Lord has for us this morning. And so with that, what I feel like God wants you to hear this morning, and what I believe God wants to speak over us, is a word of strength, a word of assurance, and a word of imagination. Strength, assurance, and imagination. And to do that, we're going to look at three different passages, one from Romans, one from Jude, and one from the book of Ephesians. And each of them begins with this incredible kind of reminder. It says, now to him who is able. That word able in the Greek, that's actually where we get words like dynamite from. God is able, God is powerful, God is explosive, God is capable of doing more than we could think. And we're going to get into some of that right here in just a minute. But I just want you to approach this with that kind of mindset, that our God is able. Our God is able to produce strength in us, supernatural strength that we can't kind of come up with on our own. Our God is able to provide assurance for us, this peace, this calmness, this hope in the midst of so much we can't control. And our God wants to gift us because he's able, because he's dynamite, because he's powerful with redeemed
imagination. And I don't know about you, but when I turn on the news and I see everything that's going on, what we need right now is some beautiful, redeemed, holy imagination that believes the world can be more than it is, that believes that we can be more than we are, not because of who we are, but because of who he is. And so I can't wait to get into that this morning with you. And so our first one is going to come from Romans chapter 16, verse 25. And so it says, "Now to him who is able to strengthen you according to my gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery that was kept secret long throughout the ages. Now to him who is able to strengthen you, our God, your God, my God, he is able to make us strong." Man, some of us have been going through quarantine. We've been going through social distancing. We've been seeing all that's happening. We've been struggling with this, that, or the other. And strength and strong are probably the last ways that we'd ever describe ourselves. But the promise of God, his capacity and his ability and his desire, not just his capacity, but his desire, he wants to do this, is to make us strong. To be strong means to be firmly established, to be rooted, to kind of have our feet really, really placed. Like if you were to put your feet like this and someone were to come push you, you'd tip over. However, when your feet are planted, you've got the ability to endure. Our God wants you to have the ability to endure, and he is the one that wants to gift you with that. He says, "Now to him who is able to strengthen you, to establish you, to firmly root you." But check this out. The foundation matters. Like, you can be incredibly strong and you can have that really solid position, but if the ground beneath you is slippery, if the ground beneath you is weak, it doesn't matter how firmly your feet are planted if the foundation beneath you isn't trustworthy. Remember what Jesus said? He said, don't build your life, don't build your house on what? On sand. You don't build your, you can, and a lot of us have. You can build your life on sand. You can build your life on career. You can build your life on family. You can build your life on money. You can build your life on success. You can build your life on a lot of wonderful, good things. But those things don't have the staying power. Those things don't have the foundation. That is shifting sand. And when life gets tough, what we find out, and what many of us especially now have been finding out, is those foundations, as good and wonderful and as beautiful as they are, aren't capable of sustaining. Some of us built our life around our jobs, and then we lost our jobs. And suddenly we realized, man, that was not a firm foundation. Some of us have been building our lives around a person. Maybe it's someone we're dating or someone we're married to or our children. We've been building our lives around them, and these are good, wonderful relationships. We're not putting down relationships. It's just there's no relationship other than Jesus Christ that has the ability and the staying power, the capacity and the strength to keep us up when everything starts falling apart. We need a firmer foundation, whether it's money or stuff or possessions or our home, whatever it might be, any foundation other than Jesus Christ is not going to be able to sustain us. So listen to what Paul says. He says, "Now to him who is able to strengthen you according to my gospel." He says, what you need to build your life upon, what God wants to build your life upon, is the gospel. See, God won't build your life. He won't give you strength. He won't give you stability. He won't give you that establishment on anything other than himself, anything other than the gospel, because he can't give you that. Because those things can't hold you up. Those things won't hold up under pressure. Those are good, wonderful things. They're just not good, wonderful things to build your life upon. Paul says God wants to establish you. He wants to make you strong, but it's going to have to be on the foundation of his choosing. And the foundation of our God's choosing is the gospel. So what is the gospel? Now look, I am not going to do the fullness of the gospel justice here. But while I'm not going to do the fullness of the gospel justice here, I hope I can give you a focused view of it. Something, a great starting point. Please don't stop here, but I think it touches on a lot of different things. And I'm pulling this from something that Paul would often say. He would say, we are saved by grace through faith. We are saved by grace through faith. I want you to think about it, especially that first part. Because we hear the word saved, and maybe we just kind of hear it and we go to grace through faith. But think about this. That word saved has so much wrapped up in it. It means the word saved implies that we need saving. There's an acknowledgement of our sin there. There's an acknowledgement that all of us, myself, all of us, every single one of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. But also, not only is there an acknowledgement of our sin, there's an acknowledgement of our inherent worth and value in the eyes of God. There's the implication of the fact that we are created in God's image. That essentially God says, you are worth saving. We're not worthy for what God has done. But thanks be to God, we're not the ones who determine whether or not we're worth it. God says you're worth it. That you are fearfully and wondrously created in his image, and he's not giving up on you, even if you've given up on you. He's not giving up because you're created in his image. I mean, think about it. We're in the process of moving, which is crazy. Like, I'm still trying to wrap my mind around this, but we're starting to go through our house and decide what is worth saving and what needs to come with us and what needs to go, right? And so something's worth is kind of determined. When you start moving, all of a sudden you realize, like, I don't know. I thought I really needed this. But now actually, now that I'm looking at it, I don't. If you were to think of God as moving, he looks at you and says, worth it. He looks at you and says, coming with me. You're going in that box that says fragile, not because you're necessarily fragile and easily broken, but because you have value. So there's this saving, this acknowledgement that we've sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. There's this acknowledgement of the fact that we're created in God's image. And then more than anything else, there's this acknowledgement that we need saving. And therefore, we have a Savior. God has done for us what we could not do for ourselves. And Jesus Christ, our Lord Jesus, lived, died, and rose again for the forgiveness of sins. He ascended to the right hand of God the Father. He poured out the Holy Spirit upon us. And he will come again to put death to death. And we receive this by grace through faith. It's by grace through faith. We've been saved by grace through faith. By grace, we acknowledge it is undeserved. It's undeserved. I didn't deserve it. And can't earn it. You can't earn it. But we don't have to. It's God's free gift. But we receive it. We participate in it through faith. We are saved by grace through faith. Again, I don't know that captures every aspect. We didn't get a lot into a creation, a new creation there, but it's a focused view. We want to build our life upon the gospel. The gospel, the fact that Jesus Christ has done for us what we could not do for ourselves and invites us to participate in it, not just through faith, but in the ongoing restoration of all things. And he's invited us into that, and God wants to build our lives upon him. Which raises the question, like, how does that happen, right? Okay, that might be a focused view of the gospel, like, but how does that take place? There's something really cool. I never really paid much attention to it until I started reading it this week. Listen to this. It says, now, this is Romans 16, verse 25 still. Now to him who is able to strengthen you according to my gospel. He doesn't say the gospel. He says my gospel. Yeah, I read that. I was like, Paul, come on, man. That's presumptuous. Look at Paul being all like, this is my gospel. Trust my gospel, but do not trust Peter's gospel. That dude's messed up. Don't listen to him, church. You know, I was like, that just feels, I don't know, just like, it just sounds arrogant. And I was like, that can't possibly be it. So let me look at it a little bit more. And then I realized that's not what Paul is saying at all. He's not saying this is mine as opposed to Peter's. He's not saying this is something I came up with on my own. That's not what he's saying. He's saying this has become mine. See, I think what Paul is trying to get is the gospel begins to become the foundation that we're building our lives upon when the gospel becomes our gospel. When we realize that what Jesus Christ has done for the whole world, he did for me. He did for me. When we begin to understand that, when we begin to recognize that what Christ has done for all, he's done for me, when it's not just theory, when it's not just theology that we keep up here, but it becomes personal and relational. We know that God has done that for us. It becomes our gospel, my gospel. When it becomes my gospel, God can begin building and establishing and making strong our lives because it's built upon him. It's a word of strength, but I told you this is not just a word of strength. It's also a word of assurance. in Jude chapter 1, verse 24, it says this: "Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy." Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling. When you hear the word stumble or stumbling, what comes to mind for you? I don't know what comes to mind for you, but I know for me, the very, very first thing that comes to mind, and Pastor Chris has been so kind to remind me of this over and over again repeatedly, is when I tried to climb on the stage a few weeks back. I don't know if y'all remember that. It wasn't pretty. I thought my recovery was pretty solid, man. You got to give me that much. I am getting a head nod. But I have a feeling there might be more video posts. I don't know. But, I mean, I tried. Anyway, when I think of stumbling, that's what I think of. It's like you come over your foot, you trip on a root, you trip on something, and you stumble. But the word here is much heavier and significant than that. It's not just stumbling, it's falling. In fact, in the Greek, it kind of comes out of this like horseback riding imagery. Like if you're riding a horse, you don't want to fall off the horse. That is not something you want to do. Have you ever rode a horse before? Like, I can remember the first time I ever rode a horse. I was a child, and I was terrified. You know, in the movies, they all make it look so easy and fun, and there's always that moment in a movie if they've got bows and arrows. I think this was like Lord of the Rings when they're, like, riding sideways and, like, hanging off the side of the horse, and they're doing all this crazy stuff. No, I just sat on the horse, and I was like, I'm not ready for this. You've got, like, this 1,000-pound beast that can do whatever it wants, and they're like, here, let me give you this string, and you can control it. I'm like, what? What am I supposed to do with this? And so people spend their lives learning to be really, really good at that. I'm not one of those people. I rode the horse at one time, realized, oh my goodness, I am not in control. This thing is terrifying. And then I didn't get on a horse again until I was a grown adult with children of my own. And I can remember Alyssa getting on the horse, and she's like, yay, this is going to be awesome. And here I am, like 30 years old, sitting on the horse like, I'm going to die. Like, this is not a good idea. Like, I was just as nervous then as I was when I was, like, 10 years old. And I think the people who were teaching us what we needed to do could see that. They could see the fear in my eyes. I'm trying to put on a good front. I'm trying to act like I've got it all together. But I don't. And so they're giving me some special attention, because what I realized in that moment is that I'm not in control. Not at all. I'm not in control of this moment. This creature can do whatever it wants. And this might sound like a weird thing to say, but COVID, this season of social distancing, has offered us sort of like a strange, severe blessing. And it's the blessing of realizing that we are not in control, that we've never been in control. In many ways before COVID, in many ways before all of this, we had the idea that we were in control, that we were masters of our own fate, that we were kind of pulling the strings and making things happen. But what this has pointed out is that that was an illusion. That wasn't reality. This is actually much more realistic. We are very much aware of the fact that we are not in control, and we're very much aware of that in a way that we never have been before. And so when I was getting on the horse, and I'm acknowledging my limitations, I'm acknowledging my need for help, I'm looking to the people who know what they're doing to help me have a sense of what to do. And here in Jude chapter 1, God is saying, look to me. Look to me. I've got you. I've got you. You don't know what to do, and that's okay. In fact, that's good, because when you don't know what to do, that's probably when you start looking to me. Look to me. I got you. I got you. No, I know you don't got this, but I got you. I got you, and I got this. Look to me. I can keep you from stumbling. I can do for you what you could not do for yourself, even though you thought you could back then. Now you know you can't, and so come here. Come here. I got you. I will keep you from stumbling. And I love what he says. I love where the text takes us next. This is beautiful. Listen to this. So we acknowledge our need for help. We acknowledge that we on our own are going to stumble. But God says, I can keep you from that. I got you even when you don't have this, even when you're struggling. I got you. I can keep you from stumbling. And then it goes on to say, and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless. Church, your God loves to present you. Your God loves to show you off. You're not blameless because you're perfect. You're not blameless because you're innocent. You're blameless because you're forgiven, because Jesus Christ has done for you what you could not do for yourself. And our God, like an incredibly good parent, loves to show off his children. I can remember when I was younger and just getting married, like some of our friends were starting to have kids, and all they would do is talk about their children. Have you ever been in that situation where maybe you yourself don't have children and all of a sudden people around you are starting to have kids and they're like, hey, look at they just stood up, or they just said their first word, or look at how cute they are. They're crawling. Look. And you're like, I don't care. That's not my kid. I don't care. Please show me something else. Anything else. I mean, you don't say that to them. You go, oh, cute. What happened to you? You know, you're like, oh, but can I tell you? I started having children, and guess who I became? I became that person who's like, I'm going to put this picture of so-and-so on Facebook. I want to look what the so-and-so did. Look at Levi. Look at Alyssa. Look at Theo. They're adorable. I show them off because they're mine. And you belong to God. And like a good parent, God loves to show off his children. And children know how to do this too, don't they? Children love to show off what they've created. Children love to show off what they've made. I can remember coming in the house and when Alyssa was little, she'd run up holding a My Little Pony drawing. And she's like, Dad, look at, isn't beautiful? It's funny, one of the characters in My Little Pony is called Rainbow Rider. And that was the name that Alyssa advocated for our dog. Rainbow Rider would have been an all-black lab terrier. And I'm just picturing, our dog's name is now Shadow. I'm picturing Shadow getting out of the house and running down the street, which all of my dogs as a kid, we always had to chase him down the street. So I'm imagining myself running down our neighborhood going, Rainbow Rider! Rainbow Rider! I'm like, hey, we ain't calling our dog Rainbow Rider. But Alyssa loved to show us her Rainbow Rider drawings. And Levi loves to show us his Lego creations. I'll come home from work. He'd be like, Dad, look, I made a fourth story. I made this. Come look at it. Even Theo, our one-year-old, he's already getting in on it. He already knows what this is. I walk in the room, and whatever he's holding, he's like, he doesn't even know what it is, but it's in his hand. Therefore, it's his. Therefore, he loves to show it off. Church, your God loves to show you off, not because you're perfect, not because you've never made mistakes, not because you've never done anything wrong, but because you're his. And when you become his through Jesus Christ, our Lord, what he did on the cross through his death and resurrection, man, it means you are forgiven. That sin is cast as far as the east is from the west. And God doesn't just save us from our sin. He saves us for good works. And one of the good things that God loves to do with his children is simply to show them off. This might sound like a weird thing to say, but I really feel like some of us need to hear this. God is incredibly proud of you. Like, as parents, we know our children aren't perfect, but we're proud of them because they're ours. Yeah, we've all got room to grow. We've all got room to acknowledge our sin and keep growing in Christ like this. We call that sanctification. But at the most basic level, I think some of us need to hear this. Our God is proud of you. Loves to show you off. And he is the one who can keep you from stumbling. And church, can I just tell you, that when I think about the strength of God and when I think about the assurance of God, this idea that God truly does love us and rejoices in us and is proud of us, that's something I've experienced here over and over again. And one of the ways I've experienced that is through each and every one of you. You've modeled to me what godly strength looks like when a life is built upon the foundation of the gospel. You have modeled to me what it looks like to rejoice in the one who can keep us from stumbling and who loves to present us, who loves to show us off, not because we're perfect, but because we're his. Thank you for modeling that for me in this place. Thank you for demonstrating that to our community and to our city. But there's one more word I feel like God has for us this morning. And we've heard a word of strength. We've heard a word of assurance. And I also think we need to hear a word of imagination. Listen to these words from Ephesians chapter 3, verses 20 through 21. Now to him who's able to do immeasurably more than we could ask or imagine, according to his power at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations forever and ever. Amen. Our God, oh my goodness, church, our God can do more. You saw it in the video. There I was some 20 years ago worshiping, wondering, God, is this all there is? And as clear as I'm talking to you, I sense God say, Bobby, as long as I am, there is always more. God is able to do more, more than we could think, more than we could dream, more than we can imagine. Isaiah 55, I believe it's verses 8 through 9, reminds us that God can, that his ways aren't our ways, that his thoughts aren't our thoughts. And it just makes me wonder, how many times have I set the limits of what God can do in my life based on the limits of my imagination, based on the limits of my thinking, based on the limits of my ways? But if God's ways aren't my ways and God's thoughts aren't my thoughts, then it means to me that where my imagination ends, God's begins. And so maybe if I want to see more growth in my life, maybe if I want to see God break open my life, maybe if I want to see more peace and truth and grace and justice flow from my life, I should trade my dreams for the dreams of God, because his are bigger and wider and wilder. And I wonder how many times I've settled for a dream that's smaller than what God would have for me. I wonder how many times I've set my limits, I've set God's limits based on what I can think rather than what he can think. And so I want you to think about this. God can do more than we could think or ask. God can do more than we could dream or imagine. And with that thought in your mind, I want you to listen to the very next verse that Paul says. This is chapter 4, verse 1 of the book of Ephesians. I therefore, a prisoner for the Lord, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you've been called, with humility, gentleness, patience, and love, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. And so Paul reminds us that God can do infinitely more than we can ask or think. And then the very next thing out of his lips is an acknowledgement that he is in prison. This isn't metaphorical language. This isn't figurative language. Paul is actually literally in prison when he is writing this. And you would think that Paul, coming out of this reminder that God can do more than he can think or dream or ask, would pray this big, audacious prayer. God, break me out of this prison cell. God, break me out of these chains. God, set me free. But here's what we see Paul do instead. After reminding us that God's dreams are bigger than ours, Paul says, I would rather see the church free of her chains than me free of mine. Paul doesn't shift into personal security. Paul shifts into a vision of what it means to be humans redeemed by God, gathered as a church that produces justice and humility and gentleness and peace and healing all throughout the world. And so, church, if our dreams for our lives are limited simply to the safety and security of our own, that's probably a dream that's too small. It's not that it's a bad dream. No, we do want to protect. We do want to care for our own. But if that's the limit of our dream, it's a dream that's too small. And it certainly wasn't the dream of Paul. Yes, I'm a prisoner. Yes, I'm in chains. But my dream for you, as I tap into this dream of God, is to see humility and gentleness and peace and justice unleashed through this community all throughout the world. Church, let's dream bigger dreams because we traded ours for the dreams of God. Amen. University of Carolina, it has been a privilege and an honor to grow up here and to be one of your pastors. Thank you so incredibly much for all that you've done in my life and in the life of my family. I love each and every one of you deeply and pray every blessing upon this church for the glory of God and the sake of the world. And so may you experience this strength that only can be found when God establishes us on the truth of the gospel. May you discover a greater assurance, a greater peace, a greater joy in knowing that our God is capable of keeping you from stumbling. And may we dream bigger dreams, the dreams of God and peace and justice and humility and gentleness for the glory of God and the sake of the world. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we love and adore you. We need you more than ever before. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Hey, I did that.
You did it, man.
I did it. Very impressive. Hey, we want to pray a big word of blessing into Pastor Bobby and his family's life today. And one of the things that the tradition in the Bible is that we lay hands on people. And right now, we can't gather around hundreds of people and lay hands on them. So what I want to ask you to do from wherever you are, just extend your hand towards Pastor Bobby as an expression of the church reaching out towards he and his family. Let's pray. Dear God, we are abundantly grateful for this man of God who has done so much in this community of faith and the way he has blessed so many people. A lot of people watched him grow up here, watched him receive his call to ministry here, watched him enter into the ordained ministry. And so, God, we pray for the church and the community that he's going to, Deer Lake and Tallahassee. We pray for his family to be received well in their new community and new church. And we pray for everybody who's grieving the loss of this family in their lives. And so, God, we just ask that you really bless them because we know that we are blessed to be a blessing. And so I pray that you will help Bobby accomplish and do more than he can ask or imagine or think, because that's who you are as our God. And we're grateful for him. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Bless you. One of the things that Pastor Bobby leaving also means that we need to do is acknowledge that that somebody is not quote unquote filling his shoes, but has their own shoes to wear, sandals, flip flops. She has her own sandals to wear, and that's Taylor Four. She's going to be the leader and the pastor at the Vessel, and we want to acknowledge that. We want to commission her and celebrate her as the great leader that she is. The Bible is filled with images of great female leadership. 3,300 years ago, God called Deborah to be a judge in the nation of Israel. And then there's Lydia, who Paul used to start the church in Philippi in Acts chapter 16. And then there's Priscilla, who Paul says of her, "You are my partner in the ministry." So I'm excited to have this wonderful partner in the ministry. And so let's once again extend our hands towards Taylor, and let's pray over her. Dear God, we do commission and celebrate her, and we want you to lift her up. We bring her to your throne of grace, and we ask you to fill her with your Holy Spirit and empower her to serve, help her to lead well. And I thank you that Bobby has been a mentor to her and poured into her so well. And that she is ready for this next season, this next journey. And we are grateful for that, God. So bless her and help her in this journey. We love you and thank you in the strong name of Jesus. We all agreed and said, amen. God bless you. Go and serve the Lord in a great and abundant love. Amen.